You're watching the free version of Silhouette Essentials. For projects and footage, head to borisfx.com for the premium download. And welcome back. We've now made quite a few different shapes here to start rotoscoping our hand. And we can see all of these shapes, not just in the viewer, but also in the timeline and in the object list. And in the object list, I can start to click through these and you'll see that they're going to be subtly highlighted to show us which one is the active one. If I double click on any of these, then it's going to let us rename them. So I'm going to rename these into something that's a little bit more useful. So I'm going to say hand main. The circle two here is going to be our forearm. The X-spline one is going to be finger index. So the pointer finger. The next one is going to be finger middle, finger ring, finger little. And then we have thumb tip and thumb main. Now we can call these, you know, whatever we want to. I like to have a little hierarchy here so I can just have a little look and just go, okay, here are all my thumbs. Well, that's the tip of the thumb. That's the main thumb. Here are my fingers. Well, that's the middle finger there. It just makes it easier to see rather than if we had like main thumb, tip thumb, little finger. It's just a little preference that I have, but I like doing it this way. We won't go too much into what these buttons are doing for now, but what I will do is I will use this color chip here to add a bit of color into my shape so we can see these here. So I'll go hand there, which I'll put into green, forearm, I'll have this as a blue, all my fingers, let's shift select to get these here, all my fingers I'll make orange, and my thumb tip and thumb main, I will make that a nice yellow. So similar, but different. If we take a little look to the right of the object list, we have our parameters and we're in our object parameters here. And you'll see the color here updates both in the object list and in the parameters. Let's just come into the node parameters here for a second. And I'm going to twirl down color and enable color. And I can turn up my fill opacity here and we'll get nice color overlays of our shape. There's a few different reasons why you might want to do this. I mean, one of them is to see where our shape is being applied to. But there's actually a more traditional and probably better way of doing it. So I'm going to turn off enable color. And this gives me a chance to take a little look at the viewer and the viewer options. If we go up to the top right, we can see we have a view channel button. And if I click on the individual color channels, we can see the individual red, green, or blue color channels. Click at the top here, we get us back into RGB. If I click in the white, we're going to go into the alpha, and we have a couple of different ways of seeing this. With one click, we get an alpha overlay. So we get this nice blue overlay of our viewer. We can control how strong this overlay is. Just to the right, so that's a opacity of that color. We'll leave that back at 30, I think. And if I click the alpha one more time, we just get a pure alpha of what's happening here. So this is going to be our black and white alpha channel. If I click one more time, we just go back into RGB. Let's turn the overlays on again by clicking on the alpha, the white, and I'm going to come over to the left a little bit, and this toggles on and off our outlines. So this is a nice way to see if we're missing anything. Let's turn my outlines back on and let's zoom in. And the easiest way of zooming in is probably just with the plus and minus keys on the number pad. Although, of course, I can also use the middle mouse button as well. So if I zoom in here, I'm actually covering the area that I need them to cover. And for the thumb, I think I'm probably going to need to add another point in here. So remember, that's just alt click. And we've got ourselves a nice meaty thumb again. Excellent. If we want to zoom out, minus on the number pad. And if we want to just zoom this back so it fits to screen, F for fit, fit to screen. The last thing we're going to look at in terms of organization is grouping shapes. And there are different levels that we can do this. Probably the most common level we're going to use is going to be layers. So adding shapes to a layer helps us to group them together. And we have an add layer button down here. So just click on that and we now have our layer, layer one. And I can shift select all of my shapes and just drag them into that layer. And we could just use this as a sort of holding layer, but we can do a lot more with it. With the layer selected, have a little look at the object parameter list. Once all these shapes are in the same layer, we can do things to them as a group. So we can blur that up, or we can change the opacity across the group. And we also have this transform area, and this is rather deep. In fact, it's a little bit too deep for right now, but if I come back into my transform tool, you can see I can transform all of those shapes as a group. And depending on where we are with this widget, we can be doing scaling, rotation, or just regular transform all within the same widget. Just undo that a couple of times with Control or Command Z. Let's open up the transform. We can see these parameters here, plus the corner pin and surface, which we'll be discussing in due course, and also this thing here, matrix. And this is a very unassuming parameter name for something that is amazingly important. In fact, it's so important, it's going to be the focus of the next section. So in this exercise, we've looked at some of the shape properties, how we can see things differently in the viewer, and how we can start to group things together with layers. In the next part, we're going to get onto motion tracking and how motion tracking relates to our mystery matrix. So join me again after the break.